I'm sure that most of you have heard the term dynamic range, but do you know how it affects your image? In this video, we'll look at how to get the best performance out of your camera by understanding how the sensor uses dynamic range. Dynamic range is the range of brightness your camera is able to see. So for example, an average human eye can see about 30 stops between pure black and pure white, kind of like the number of shades your eyes is able to see. It's expressed in stops, where one stop equals the doubling or reducing by half the amount of light. Most cameras don't even come close to the human eyes. On average, a camera can only see about 10 to 12 stops. And high-end cameras can get up to 16 stops today when shooting in RAW or log profile. The dynamic range is important because this will have a direct effect on the performance of the sensor. The larger the dynamic range, the more information is captured by the sensor, allowing the camera to better perform in low lights and in high contrast situation. Middle gray is used as the reference for exposure. So when looking at a dynamic range chart, you'll see that it will measure the number of stops above and below middle gray. Middle gray should be exposed around 40 IRE, but every format will have specific requirement to expose middle gray correctly. So for example, using Sony's S-Log3, middle gray should be exposed at 41 IRE, while Canon C-Log format recommend middle gray to be exposed at 33 IRE. So you'll need to learn the specific requirement for the format that you're using. Everything else in your image should be exposed at various level of stops in comparison to middle gray. Light skin tone should be about 1.5 stops above middle gray. If using a camera with a small dynamic range, you might be left with only 2 stops above skin tones before the image turns to pure white. Using a large dynamic range sensor will provide more stops in the highlights and in the shadows, making it possible to capture more details before clipping the highlights and crushing the blacks. When looking at the dynamic range charts provided by the manufacturers, like for my Sony FX6 for example, you can see that the native ISO 800 provides the most balanced range of stops in the highlights and in the shadows, with 6 stops above middle gray and 9 stops below middle gray. Manufacturers will also display how the dynamic range is shifted up or down at various ISO levels, resulting in less or more stops in the highlights and the shadows. Adjusting your ISO above native ISO will result in noise. Remember that ISO is an amplification of the video signal. One stop or doubling of the ISO is equal to a gain of 6 dB. Adjusting the ISO below native ISO is often called negative ISO, where you can get more dynamic range in the shadows with negative gain to the signal. Here we can see that when setting our EI to 400 or one stop below native or negative 6 dB of gain, the dynamic range shifts to give us an extra stop in the shadows and one less stop in the highlights. When setting our EI to 200 or 2 stops below native, we now have 2 extra stops below middle gray for a total of 11 stops below middle gray and a negative 12 dB. I had to test this to believe it. And because I didn't have a printed grayscale chart, I used a digital one and pointed my camera at the monitor. Now I know this is far from being the best way to test this, but the results are obvious. Filming at native 800, you can see grain in the shadows and very few details in the gray. The waveform is also showing a fairly dirty signal with peaks and valleys. With my EI set to 200, the grain is gone and the grays have a lot more details. The signal is also much cleaner on the waveform monitor. So yes, in low lights, lowering your ISO might actually be a good option to get the most details in the shadow and limit the amount of noise. Now be careful because you are giving up 2 stops in the highlights and they'll clip rather quickly. Now this also applies to dual native ISO camera. The same approach can be done in the high base ISO. Understand that we're not talking about making your image brighter. Middle gray still needs to be exposed the same way. This is a way to get the most out of the dynamic range of your camera. And the same applies to many other manufacturers. I typically never deviate from shooting in native ISO, but after this quick test, I'll continue to experiment shooting in negative ISO. I hope this video was helpful in understanding dynamic range and how to get the most out of your camera. Feel free to share your experience shooting in negative ISO. Thank you for watching this video till the end. As a token of my appreciation, I'd like to offer you my free camera setting cheat sheet. Just follow the link below to download the free cheat sheet. Thanks again, and happy filming.